Hi everyone, this is Jim. Welcome to round 12 coverage of the Zurich Candidates Tournament, the 1953 Zurich Candidates Tournament. For round 12, I selected this interesting game between Taimanov and Geller. This was a really exciting round. 5 out of 7 games were decisive, but this game had a really nice strategic theme to it, so I thought it'd be a great one to show you guys. To give a little preview of the game, what happens in this game is that Taimanov with the white pieces gets a large space advantage, and what the game is about from this point of view in this video is it's about how you take an advantage like that, an advantage in space, which is just positional, and how you convert that into a win. So take a look at Grandmaster technique in this game. So Taimanov with the white pieces, he was a Russian Grandmaster, also a concert pianist. He's 88 years old, so he's one of the two players from this tournament who are still alive today, as I'm making this video. And his opponent, Efim Geller, is a Soviet, a Ukrainian champion, a grandmaster, and a world candidate champion many times. So another strong player. Or I guess that's kind of redundant in this tournament. They all seem to be strong players. I'm going to go through the opening quickly. This is just a standard position you get to in the King's Indian defense. So these are all very common moves. Top choice in the opening book, many of them. So you just get the big center here. You bring the knight up first to support the e-pawn. And black castles here, a little more common to play d6, but we transpose into a classical King's Indian right here with the knight move and bishop e2. This is the classical setup against the King's Indian. And now e5 was played here. The Mar del Plata variation, maybe a little more common, is e5 is the main move here. Castles. And now knight bd7. I was going to say, the Mar del Plata variation with knight c6 is more common these days, but knight bd7 is a second choice and a very respectable way to play. And this is the main line, getting the rook in the center, c6. So the idea with knight bd7 is you're not blocking the c-pawn, so you're going to set up this center and try and hold. And if this pawn comes forward, you have the option of exchanging or pushing, and we'll see that in the game. So bishop f1. Rook to e8 is a bit unusual, but still a common choice. I guess today the black players are trying the move a5 to try and sharpen things up a bit. This game gets into a position where after d5, c5, things are kind of locked up. And this is the source of the space advantage. You see that white has these three rows for his pieces, and pretty much freedom of motion here, whereas white is also intruding into some squares here. So black has basically two rows to maneuver in, and all his pieces are going to be a bit crowded in this game. But still, black sets up a very solid defensive setup, and it's not normally enough to win. Now, white continues with g3. this move has an interesting idea, which is to slow down the f5 push. That's black's plan in these King's Indian setups, is to move this knight out of the way, push f5. And it's not clear how g3 affects f5. You'll have to play a few more moves to see it. But after g3, knight to f8 is played. Black is maneuvering his knights a bit. a3, setting up for the traditional, you know, it's the standard King's Indian setup where black is attacking on the king side and white is attacking on the queen side. So just preparing the move b4 there. Knight to g4 was played here by black. So getting his knight out of the way and preparing the move f5. Now knight to h4, putting some pressure on this square. And then a6. And the answer to the question, why not f5 here, and how come g3 helped prevent it, is if you play f5 right here at this point, cancel that, at f5, then white can take. And black wants to take back with the pawn. This is the usual setup. Black has got pieces around his king, so he's not afraid of creating an opening here. He wants to have the center influence with the two pawns. So Black almost always takes back with this pawn in this situation. But now white has the move bishop h3. And now that's the point of the move g3 there. It opened up this diagonal for the bishop. So that's Taimanov, I'm sure he's played this position many times, so he was setting this up. And in this position, it's just a little bit awkward for black to defend everything. The chess engine is recommending e4, and then there'll be an exchange over here, and things are a bit uncomfortable. But he can't maintain his center here. It's just under fire. So he played a6 here, a bit of a passive move. Knight to what's recommended? Bishop to f6 is another try here. And then f3 kicking the knight, taking advantage of this this awkward position of the knight and the fact that the bishop has blocked it. The chess engine is actually recommending the knight should just retreat back to f6, and rather than trying to play something adventurous like this. But, you know, black is trying to follow through with his plan of attacking on the king side with this move bishop f6, f3 counterattacking, and then after an exchange. Cancel that. Oh, yeah. Take back the bishop first, and then the knight has to drop back to f6, and bishop g5. Cancel that, bishop g5, and then white has a good game from this position. It's true that black has created a pawn weakness, but you see that white has still the advantages of space. So anyway, a6 maybe was not the best move here, but it is difficult already for black to find an alternative. And like I said, the chess engine is recommending just retreating the knight to there. So so white's strategy, the combination of the knight here on h4 and the pawn to g3, allowing the bishop to come out to h3, has put the brakes on black's plan of expansion. And so he's just making a move over on the queen side. And now white continues to develop on the queen side. This is where his play is, bishop to d2. Looking out, actually it's looking on both sides of the board, but developing, getting ready for rooks to move. H5 now, setting up more of a defensive setup. H3 kicking the knight back, knight drops back. B4, okay, advancing with the on the queen side. And now B6 and the exchange. So this has created an open file here. Let's see, hang on just a second. Instead of taking right away, yeah, it's possible to bring the knight back to f3. The knight is a bit loose here, and maybe that's a better move. But this is an okay way to play too. Bishop takes c5, and rook to b1, grabbing the b file. That was the idea with the exchange, is that this file opens up to white's advantage. He gets the rook on it first, and notice this square is not protected, so black can't oppose it. And now rook to e7 maybe is a good idea here to try and set up some kind of defense along the 7th rank. Geller played knight to d7. And now queen to a4. So just continuing to mobilize on the queen side, building up a big advantage over there. Now bishop to f6, hitting the knight. Saw this idea before. And then just retreating the knight was played here. There's an interesting note about queen c6. I just thought I'd mention this. Queen c6 is an idea in this position. The queen goes to c6. Black has the idea of trying to trap the queen with rook a7, trying to take away all the squares. Rook a7, queen takes d6, and rook to c7. And the idea now is there's this threat with the bishop, and the queen will have no squares to go to. That's protected by the bishop, that's protected by the knight, etc. But it turns out in this position, knight b5, a funny move, putting the knight where it can be attacked. Attacked by a pawn, rather. But it gives an escape square for the queen. If you take the knight, then bishop to a5 attacks the rook, and so there's no time to trap the queen. If you play the bishop here, the queen is just going to grab the rook. So it turns out queen c6 is a playable move here. I think, well, Bronstein in his commentary thought that queen c6 could not be played because of the queen trap. And it was later discovered, actually, that because of this knight b5 trick, it is safe to play queen to b6 there. But knight f3 is a reasonable move, just moving the knight away from the exchange and keeps the advantage for white. White still has all this space, which is what I was talking about earlier. And he also has advantage on the queen side where he controls that. So h4 was pushed. You know, black is just trying to get some counterplay going here. Once again, the chess engine is recommending more defensive move, maybe rook to a7, trying to cover some of the squares on the seventh rank. But anyways, when you play the King's Indian, it's very typical. You've got to go for counterplay and try and get something going on the king side to help defuse white's queen side attack, help distract from that. It's just in this particular game, it's not coming fast enough. Now, white played the move knight to d1 here, and it actually is possible just to take that pawn. If you're wondering, you know, wasn't that a pawn sack? Yes, it was a pawn sack, and it is okay to take, actually. With the chess engine here, we can look at this and be assured that it's safe. But in a real game, maybe it's not so easy to see. After you take with the knight, certainly the bishop is going to take the knight. Pawn takes back, queen takes, and you know, it's going to open up some lines towards the king. And white is just not wanting to play that way. He wants to keep a solid advantage here. So rather than grab the pawn, he played the move knight d1. He wants to maneuver this knight about. We'll see where it's going in a little bit. So black goes ahead and takes. Take back. So he did open the f file, but these two pawns in front of the king are still controlling a lot of squares, and so white is still relatively secure here. Now knight to b8 was played, trying to maneuver his pieces, and now you have this this complete setup where all black's pieces are on the back rank. There was a comment made that only all he has to do is play bishop to h8 and he's finished his setup. This is partly because, I mean, he's maneuvering that knight for a reason. He's getting the knight out of the way so the bishop can go to the square d7 and chase the queen away. So it wasn't like a pointless move. It just points out the difficulty that black has, that all of his pieces only have one or two squares to go to. Actually, the rook only has one legal move here. The knight only has one safe move. The bishop has two moves. You know, a lot of these pieces are really restricted in where they can go to. This knight has two moves, but definitely a real space disadvantage. And if you look at white has this box here where not only has he cleared out all of black's influence, there's no influence by black on these squares, he's also moved his pawns forward. So his pieces are free to move around in this box of squares to whatever extent he likes. And so this is the situation we're getting to. He's got this space advantage, and how does he take advantage of it. He starts with rook e3, so right away taking advantage of that box of squares. He can bring this rook over to the b-file. Knight to h7, just trying to regroup and get things a little better organized. Rook here, and now bishop to d7, hitting the queen. So taking advantage of that spot that opened up. Black is actually putting up a very tough defense. He's you know, he's kind of maneuvered his pieces about, but he hasn't created any weaknesses. And so there's no immediate way to break through. Everything's protected. Here, white played the move queen a5. And offering a queen trade, which could be played here. Let's take a look at it. It's black decided not to play this way. Queen takes. Bishop takes. And I think black just decided this would be harder to defend without the queen. Now there's no way to stop the rook from invading on b7. It looks like this would be a tough kind of position to play. So anyway, Geller thought his chances lie best with keeping the queens on. He played queen c8. And now knight to f2. So the knight is looking out on both sides of the board from this position, but it may have ideas of coming over and attacking. Either way, bishop to d8, chasing the queen again. Queen drops back to c3, and now bishop to a4 continuing to harass, cancel that, bishop to a4, continuing to harass white's pieces. The rook just dropped back to b2. So I guess he felt it was premature to play b7, although that is a playable move. It's one of the engine's choices, but this is equally good, maybe slightly better. Knight to d7 here. So having used that square for the bishop, now the knight can come back out. And h4. So this is the move I wanted to call your attention to. So there's a rule in chess, and I would say it's the general rule, that when you're evaluating your position, one of the things you want to think about is which side of the board to attack on. And the general rule is you want to attack on the side of the board where you have the advantage. And this is going to be the right choice 9 times out of 10. And so here, clearly, it's the queen side. He's got all his pieces lined up this way, except the knights are over here. So one strategy in this position might be just to migrate your knights this way and go after the bishop. And I would say that's probably the most common strategy. I think 9 times out of 10, that's what you want to play. But Geller has the idea of playing on both sides of the board. And he's starting an action with this move h4. He's starting an action over on the king side with the idea of distracting some of black's pieces and enabling a later invasion on the queen side where he has the advantage. So, when I was younger, I saw a game that was similar to this where the white player had an advantage in space. He took advantage of that to be able to move his pieces quickly from one side of the board to the other, and he used a distraction on the opposite side of the board. And I was so impressed with this game that I tried to use this strategy in my own games many times. So it became sort of a stylistic quirk, if you will. And then one time, so not too long ago, I was playing a game at the club, and then afterwards I was going over it with one of the experts. And they said, well, look at this position. You've developed this tremendous advantage on the queen side. Why are you making moves on the king side? You should be playing over here. So that is the general rule. So 9 times out of 10, if you have an advantage on one side of the board, that's where you want to play. You want to increase your advantage there, or take advantage of the extra space that you have or the extra pieces you have, and just break through on the side where you have the advantage. So it's this kind of game where white embarks on adventures on the other side of the board, away from where they have the advantage, is very interesting, but it's not the most typical case. So first, just in your own games, first look to the side of the board where you have the advantage, and then if you can't find a way to break through, then maybe you can play on the opposite side of the board. But anyway, it makes for a very nice game here. So now, rook a7, finally getting this idea of trying to defend against the invasions. Bishop to h3, continuing to place pieces over on the king side and pinning the knight. The queen goes to c7 to unpin. Knight to g5 and allowing this exchange. So knight takes and bishop takes. So yet another piece comes over to the king side and bishop takes and pawn takes. And not only have we moved pieces on the king side, but we've created a weakness over here that that black could attack. And the most stubborn defense here, I would have to say that black has been really playing a tough defense and not giving any real advantages to white. He's just holding on, other than the initial space advantage, he's been holding on. Right here, he has an opportunity to play a move, queen d8. Queen d8, taking advantage of the fact that this pawn is a bit loose and forcing white to come over and defend. And this just interrupts white's plans a little bit. And let's see, knight to f8. And now knight to g4, so continuing on the king side. But this looks like a position maybe black could hold. He didn't play that. Instead, he played the move king g7. Of course, now we are quite a few moves into the game at this point. We're on move 33, and the time control is at move 40. So at some point, I think the pressure sort of gets to you. So black has been holding on in this really tough defense, but you've got to find precise move after precise move to really to really hold off in a position like this. And you start burning time on the clock, and then you get into time pressure. So there's only 7 minutes to make the time control. And now here's one of the star moves of the game. It's Queen F3. So this is what I was talking about. You've got all this space here and unobstructed lines. So the queen quickly shifts. I said that, shiftly. Quickly shifts from one side of the board to the other. And because black has maneuvered his pieces over here onto the queen side to defend, it's not so easy for him to get back and defend on the king side quickly. So anyway, queen to d8 is played now, hitting this pawn. But already white's advantage is so strong that he can ignore the threat to the pawn and just proceed with rook b7. Finally, having distracted or disorganized black's pieces a little bit by this attack on the king side, he goes back to the queen side where his advantage is. And now rook takes b7 is pretty much the only move there. And king to g8 was played here. I think queen takes g5 is the toughest defense, if we can look at it. Queen takes g5, bishop takes d7. It loses a piece. Bishop takes, rook takes, or let's see, or rook to e7 defending, trying to hold on to everything, or pinning rather, trying to hold on to everything, but just bishop to c6 defending the rook. And white emerges a piece up. So that's the most stubborn defense, because black at least got a pawn for his troubles. But and he'll get another one too, because there's queen c1 check and grabbing the c pawn. So we'll have two pawns for the piece, but still a winning advantage for white. So not wanting to give up the piece right away, he tried the move king back to g8. But after bishop takes d7, the game really falls apart. Bishop takes. And now knight to g4, the knight comes in. So finally, all white's pieces are mobilized. The queen side invasion and the queen over here on the king side are coordinating on black's position, and there's just no way to hold everything. He played queen takes g5 here, but now rook takes d7. This bishop was just hanging and could not be defended anymore because of the threat of knight to f3 check. He couldn't meet all the threats, right? There's the threat to the bishop, and knight to f3 check just wins it. So queen takes g5 was played, and rook takes d7, f5, just a couple more moves to make the time control. E takes, rook b8, and then at this point they made their 40 moves. Black had time to reflect and look at the position and resigned here, because there's nothing else going on in the position, no way to save it. Well, first of all, it's white's move here, so he can continue with f takes and threatening a mate down here. There's no, black can throw in this check, but the king can just come to g2, and then here he can block with the knight. And there's no way to stop the invasion at this point. Queen takes g6 is probably the best try, but the king is too open. Rook d8, king h7, queen f8, and white is just crashing through. Now, I'll put this on the board. The king has to move, and the queen comes in. So the white king is secure. The knight actually covers this square. Let's see. It's not, actually, that's not true. The knight is pinned. Let's see if black tries one more adventure here. Just king to h3, and finally he's out of trouble. Okay, that's just a desperado. I was going to say, yeah, I was making sure there was no more tricks there. So, yeah, all black can do at that point is throw pieces away. Okay. So let's back up to the final position. It was right here. Black played the move rook b8. They made the 40th move, and then black resigned at this point. So pretty interesting strategic game. Good example of grandmaster technique and taking advantage of when you have the advantage in space, how to utilize that advantage. So at the end of the 12th round, like I said, there were a lot of decisive games. Ryshevsky did not play in this round. This was his bye round. And Smyslov won. So Smyslov is now leading the tournament with 8 points. And Ryshevsky is in second place with 7.5. Just a half point behind them is Neidorf. Neidorf had a nice win today. And seven, so who's at 6.5? I thought there was somebody. Yeah, and Bronstein is at 6.5. So it's Smyslov, Ryshevsky, Neidorf, and Bronstein in that order. Those are the top four in the tournament. And stay tuned for coverage of round 13. I will see you soon. Bye.